Good evening. One quick announcement before we get started. Next Wednesday night, our soup and pie committee are hosting a supper before our service. So if you are able, you are welcome and invited to come next Wednesday starting at 5:30, probably between 5:30 and 6:30, to join us for a time of food and fellowship in preparation for our service later on that evening. So again, mark your calendars if that's something that you would like to do. We'd love to have you here joining us for that. That's our early announcement. Let's get started. Our order of service tonight, again, is Compline Prayer at the Close of Day, which begins on page 253 in the front part of our hymnals. Please rise. We speak responsibly the words that are printed out there in the hymnal. The Lord Almighty grant us a quiet night and peace at the last.
Amen.
It is good to give thanks to the Lord, to sing praise to your name, O Most High, to herald your love in the morning, your truth at the close of day. Let us now confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Holy and gracious God, I confess that I have sinned against you this day. Some of my sin I know, the thoughts and words and deeds of which I am ashamed, but some is known only to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, I ask forgiveness. Deliver and restore me, that I may rest in peace. By the mercy of God, we are redeemed by Jesus Christ, and in him we are forgiven. We rest now in his peace and rise in the morning to serve him. Amen. Our psalmody for tonight is taken from Psalm 38. It's printed out for you in the bulletin so that we may read it now responsively. O Lord, rebuke me not in your anger,
nor discipline me in your wrath.
For my iniquities have gone over my head.
Like a heavy burden, they are too heavy for me.
I am feeble and crushed.
I groan because of the tumult of my heart.
But for you, O Lord, do I wait.
It is you, O Lord my God, who will answer me.
I confess my iniquity.
I am sorry for my sin.
Do not forsake me, O Lord.
O my God, be not far from me.
Make haste to help me,
O Lord, my salvation.
Please be seated. We now sing the office hymn, Jesus Grant That Balm and Healing, hymn 421.
Thank you.
Testament reading for tonight comes from the prophet Jeremiah, chapter 15. Therefore, thus says the Lord, if you return, I will restore you, and you shall stand before me. If you utter what is precious and not what is worthless, you shall be as my mouth. They shall turn to you, but you shall not turn to them. And I will make you to this people a fortified wall of bronze. They will fight against you, but they shall not prevail over you. For I am with you to save you and deliver you, declares the Lord. I will deliver you out of the hand of the wicked and redeem you from the grasp of the ruthless. Our New Testament reading for tonight comes from Paul's second letter to the Christians in Corinth, these words from chapter 5. From now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh. Even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. We rise now for the reading of the gospel. Tonight's gospel reading comes from Luke's gospel, chapter 18. As Jesus drew near to Jericho, a blind man was sitting by the roadside begging. And hearing a crowd going by, he inquired what this meant. They told him, Jesus of Nazareth is passing by. And he cried out, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. And those who were in front rebuked him, telling him to be silent. But he cried out all the more, son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stopped and commanded him to be brought to him. And when he came near, Jesus asked him, what do you want me to do for you? He said, Lord, let me recover my sight. And Jesus said to him, recover your sight. Your faith has made you well. And immediately he recovered his sight and followed Jesus, glorifying God. And all the people, when they saw it, gave praise to God. We now speak responsively the responsory on page 255. Into your hands, O Lord, I commend my spirit.
Into your hands I commend my spirit.
You have redeemed me, O Lord, God of truth.
Into your hands I commend my spirit.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
Into your hands I commend my spirit.
Please be seated. Our sermon hymn is hymn 423, Jesus, Refuge of the Weary.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God, our Heavenly Father, and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. This past week, I was asked an interesting question. Someone wanted to know, have I ever felt so worn out that I didn't think I could go on? And if so, what did I do about it? Well, my first thought, and which was probably the most honest one, but it wasn't a good one, was that when I feel that way, I just keep going. But then I thought about it some more, and the Spirit's wisdom prevailed, and I gave a better answer. I said, when that happens, it's usually my own fault, because I've strayed from the source of my strength and comfort. So once I go back and do my daily devotions and my prayers, those things normally help me to feel much better. Now, of course, whatever problems I may have, they certainly pale in comparison to the things that other folks may be dealing with. Some people have lost loved ones. Others are forced to watch their loved ones suffer. Or perhaps they have health problems of their own. Some folks are still anxious about their financial situations. Others have been rejected and made to feel unloved and unimportant. There are many people at various times in their lives who can say they know what it feels like to be worn out, torn down, and ready to give up. Although we may not always realize it, all of those feelings are the result of sin. Sometimes that suffering is caused by the sins we've committed. But other times, more often than not, it's due to the sins of others. And of course, all of us are forced to suffer because of the sin of our first parents. They were the ones who brought sin into the world, and with it all kinds of hatred and hardships and hurt. But you know, there's another kind of suffering that we experience. It's the suffering we experience because we haven't sinned. And what I mean by that is that sometimes the reason that we suffer is because we are faithful followers of Christ. How many times in our lives have we experienced rejection from our friends and family? How many times have we felt abandoned or mocked simply because we're striving to live our lives in a way that's pleasing to God? Rather than being silent about our faith and keeping our beliefs to ourselves, we proudly bear the name of Jesus and are not afraid to follow him with our words and our deeds. But sometimes that can lead to loneliness and pain. If anyone knows what that's like, it was the prophet Jeremiah. As some of you may have heard before, Jeremiah is known as the weeping prophet. And one of the reasons for that is because he was forced to suffer all kinds of terrible things as a result of carrying out the work God called him to do. Now, being a faithful follower of God in any time or place is hard enough. But God called Jeremiah to do even more. He commanded Jeremiah to not only live a godly life, but also to call others to do the same, and then to condemn them if they refused to repent of their sinful ways. Now, who in their right mind would willingly sign up for a task like that? It reminds me of a question that my former students used to ask me all the time. They wanted to know whether or not it was okay for them to go to a drinking party, as long as they themselves didn't drink. And I said, sure, of course it's okay for you to go to those parties, as long as you don't drink, and if you promise to go there and tell everybody else not to drink either. In all of my years, there was not one time where a kid took me up on that offer. Now, why is that? Well, it's because who wants to be that guy? Who wants to be the one who knowingly upsets and offends other people? Nobody. But Jeremiah didn't have a choice. God commanded him to be that guy. That doesn't mean that Jeremiah liked it, though. In fact, in the verses that were leading up to tonight's Old Testament reading, Jeremiah was filled with so much anguish that he actually lamented the fact that he'd even been born. Clearly, he was worn out from the work that God had called him to do and was ready to give up. Thankfully, Jeremiah knew where to go when he had those feelings. He went to God because he knew that God's the only one who can restore us when we've reached our lowest point. And as Jeremiah prayed to the Lord, he reminded the Lord that the whole reason that he was suffering in the first place was for the sake of God's name and for being faithful to God's call. And after saying all of that, Jeremiah wanted to know, God, are you going to abandon me? Are you going to let me face my enemies all alone? Or are you going to come to my aid and help me? And that's when God responded with what you heard earlier tonight, these words, if you return, I will restore you, and you shall stand before me. In other words, if you stop trying to handle all of these things by yourself and put your hope in me, then I will renew your strength and restore you. And after that, God assured Jeremiah, as you saw in our Old Testament text, that he would continue to be with Jeremiah and protect him and enable him to finish carrying out the work that God called him to do. Now, I wish I could tell you that after that, Jeremiah lived happily ever after. But he didn't. He continued to suffer many things until eventually his work was done. And yet, through it all, Jeremiah was able to keep going. Because what he wanted from God was not an easy life, but for God to be with him. And certainly God didn't promise Jeremiah an easy life. But he did promise to be with him and to bless him. And God kept that promise. He continued to love Jeremiah and to give him the strength that he needed to keep going. And for Jeremiah, that was enough. And it was enough because in the midst of his suffering, Jeremiah cried out to the Lord, not only to vent his fears and his frustrations, but also to express confidence in God's goodness and to give him thanks for all that God had done. That, in a nutshell, is what a lament is all about. They are cries to God seeking his protection and peace, followed by declarations of praise for what God has already done and for what he has promised to do in the future. That's why in the Bible, a true lament always required faith, because the person needed to be able to hold on to the promises God made. I don't know if you know this or not, but Jeremiah is the one who wrote the book of Lamentations, which is a book full of laments. But in the midst of all of that, we can still see the weeping prophet's faith. As he described all kinds of heartbreaking grief, Jeremiah declared, "This I call to mind, and therefore I have hope. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore I will hope in him." And the same thing is true when it comes to the lament psalms that David included in his book of Psalms. There we see that same pattern holding true. First, the child of God addresses him and cries out to him with whatever pain or problems they're having or suffering. Sometimes the problem was even God himself. But then the lamenting saint would go on to express his trust in God, knowing that God will hear him and answer him. Tonight's psalmody is an example of a lament psalm. In it, you saw David confess his sin and acknowledge that God's law is going to crush him unless God does something to save him. And David declared, "For you, O Lord, I do wait. It is you, O God, who will answer. So even though David knew that his sin had made God his enemy, he also knew that there was only one Savior who could rescue him and restore him, and it was God himself. And that's true for us too. No matter what the problem is, God is always the solution. And that's why God's message to Jeremiah is also his message to you tonight. If you return to me, I will restore you, and you shall stand before me. When you're feeling oppressed by the wickedness of this world, or overwhelmed by the guilt of your own sins, return to the Lord, and he will restore you, as he promised to do. Come and receive his healing and forgiveness. Come and receive his comfort and peace. Come and be restored by his strength. By faith, we can cry out with confidence, as the blind man did in tonight's gospel reading, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on us." Because we know that he always hears us, and he cares, and he answers. The faith that we need to believe those promises is continually restored and renewed in us through the word and the sacrament that we receive here. Through these gifts of grace, our Lord comes to us and does calm our deepest distresses. He forgives all our sins and strengthens our faith so that we can keep going even when the going gets really, really tough. In this world, sometimes we are going to be weeping prophets. Ones who are beaten down by the wickedness of this world, heartbroken over the sins that we've committed, and ashamed at how easily we've been misled by Satan's lies. Yet through it all, our Lord continually comes to us and gently encourages us, saying, "Return to me, and I will restore you." That word restore literally means to return to the place where you started. For us, we all started out at the dawn of creation as the holy and innocent children of God, perfect in both body and spirit. But of course, Adam and Eve's sin changed all that, such that now all people are conceived in sin and come into the world already as enemies of God. All of us have inherited the original sin of our parents, and we are afflicted by it all our earthly days. Yet God's promise to us is that when we return to him, he will restore us. When we hear his word and receive our Lord's body and blood, we are born again. By God's grace through faith, paradise is restored in us. We are new creations. The old has gone. The new has come. This is from God, who reconciled us to himself through the death and resurrection of his Son, so that we might stand before him forever in everlasting righteousness and blessedness. God accomplished all of this by fulfilling for us his righteous law. He himself is the one who offered the once-for-all sacrifice that took away the sins of all people, of all times and places. Now, in the Old Testament, God enabled his people to see with their own eyes that their sins were being paid for and removed from them through the system of sacrificial offerings that took place in the temple. But one sacrifice in particular was especially powerful and meaningful for those who witnessed it. An unblemished lamb was brought forward to the place where the altar was, and there the priests would place their hands on that lamb and confess the sins of all the people. God promised that when the priests did that, the sins of the people would be transferred onto the lamb. And then the lamb was killed to show the people that their sins had been paid for and completely removed from them. With the death of that perfectly innocent lamb, they knew that their sins were forgiven and that they were restored to God once more. Unfortunately, that was only a temporary solution that needed to be repeated over and over again. But God knew that mankind needed a better and more permanent sacrifice that would fulfill God's law perfectly and forever. And God promised his people that someday that perfect lamb would come and complete that sacrifice. Well, my dear friends in Christ, you know that Jesus was that sacrificial lamb, the one that God offered for us to fulfill his promise. All of our sins were transferred onto him when God made him who knew no sin to become sin for us. Then he was sacrificed on a cross-shaped altar so that we could see our sins being removed from us forever. And in their place, by God's grace through faith, we have received Christ's perfect righteousness. This is the blessed and miraculous exchange that takes place when God restores us to himself by the power of his Spirit. And thanks be to God, we have been restored to God, all for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. But we haven't been completely restored, not yet, because we've not yet returned to where we started, with perfect bodies and perfect souls, the way that we were when God first created us. But our Lord has promised that that day is coming, when we shall have those things. And when that day comes, God will fulfill that final promise to come. Until then, let us continue to return to the Lord in all things, so that he may continually restore us and give to us his grace, his mercy, and his peace, now and forevermore. Amen. Our service now continues with the collection of our offerings. As the offerings are brought forward, you are all invited to please rise and sing verses 1 and 6 of hymn 883. All praise to thee, my God, this night. Hymn 883. We continue now with the prayers that begin on page 256 in the front part of our hymnals. Hear my prayer, O Lord. Listen to my cry. Keep me as the apple of your eye.
Hide me in the shadow of your wings.
In righteousness I shall see you. When I awake, your presence will give me joy. O Lord, support us all the day long of this troubled life, until the shadows lengthen and evening comes, and the busy world is hushed. The fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then, Lord, in your mercy, grant us safe lodging and a holy rest, and peace at the last. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Taught by our Lord and trusting his promises, we are bold to pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We also speak Luther's evening prayer as it is printed out in the bulletin. Dwell among us, O Lord, and in your great mercy defend us from all perils and dangers of this night. For the love of your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. I thank you, my heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have graciously kept me this day. And I pray that you would forgive me all my sins where I have done wrong, and graciously keep me this night. For into your hands I commit myself, my body and soul and all things. Let your holy angels be with me, that the evil foe would have no power over me. Amen. We continue with the Nunc Dimittis, which is printed out for you in the bulletins, so that we can speak it responsively. Guide us waking, O Lord,
and guard us sleeping,
that awake we may watch with Christ,
and asleep we may rest in peace.
Lord, now you let your servant go in peace.
Your word has been fulfilled.
My own eyes have seen the salvation,
which you have prepared in the sight of every people,
a light to reveal you to the nations,
and the glory of your people Israel.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
Amen.
Guide us waking, O Lord,
and guard us sleeping,
that awake we may watch with Christ,
and asleep we may rest in peace.
The Almighty and Merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit bless you and keep you. Amen. You may be seated now for our closing hymn, Lamb of God, hymn 550.